Today's Monday, August 8th, and the time is 5:03 p.m. Welcome, everyone.
Recording in progress.
Thank you, Lynn. We are going to skip the first item because we are waiting for our city solicitor, Fred, to arrive. Hi, Mayor. Good evening. Welcome. Okay. So we're going to jump right on to item number two, which is Council Staff Evaluation Committee. And this is because we need to discuss the next steps. We have already identified council members who will be participating in that evaluation. And Mr. Gumbar, advises of next steps.
I would suggest the first step is to have a meeting of the committee with myself, and then we can kind of create a roadmap from there of the actions that the committee needs to take as far as the evaluations and any other matters that the committee needs to undertake. So I would suggest we do it sometime this month, if possible. Yeah.
Do we want to look at our calendars right now, just so that we can maybe set time? Yep. So on the committee are Chris, right? I believe it was it Marsha? Mm-hmm. And myself. Okay.
We're in the other one.
Yeah, you're on the...
You're on the Rawa one, yeah.
Okay. Is this one that could be?
I don't see why not.
Yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Right, because it's us meeting to discuss.
Yeah.
When we're going to conduct.
I have a Zoom account that I can host as well then too.
All right. So, do you have a date in mind? This week, next week? What are we looking at? Or did you want to send out an email to us?
Well, do you prefer later in the day? Is that easier? Or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like anytime after 2 p.m. is good for me. What about for you, Chris?
I'm starting pretty soon. I'm occupied.
And Marsha, is after 4 better for you?
It depends on the day of the week, whether I have anything scheduled. Do you want me to some specific dates for next week?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, cause maybe, would like next Monday the 15th, are Mondays good for you, Marsha? Or?
It doesn't really matter the day of the week. It depends on when I have appointments scheduled. So
got it.
Monday, I may have someone scheduling something for a late lunch, and then after that, I'll be available. So that would work. Like just as long as I'm back in here by 4 o'clock for nominations.
I'd be fine for 3 p.m.
That's good.
Okay, sounds good. I'm gonna marking our calendar, so August 15, 3 p.m.
All right, and I'll send out the Zoom link.
Perfect. Okay, are we, and Mayor, deeply sorry for your loss. Thank you for being here. So now we're going to jump back to item one, which is 5G zoning amendment, and I believe, is it Fred Latchett that will be leading that conversation, or the gentleman that's connected with us virtually?
Yeah, so Mike Roberts from Cullen Law Group is joining us. I think we part of this would be advice of legal counsel, and we would need to maybe break off unless we would just wanted to talk very generally about the zoning ordinance. It's up to you all. I did share the zoning draft for so if anyone had any questions, but there are some things that would be legal advice that we could either do like do that in writing in an email, or we could do an executive session. So but they're generally discussing what would be proposed in this amendment. I think that could be done publicly.
So how do we want to proceed?
I said, we could start off just discussing the ordinance mm-hmm. in public. Mike, does that seem like a good plan?
Yeah, that's fine with me. However, council would like to proceed.
And if there are questions that are more seeking legal advice, we could save them and then move into an executive session. Does that work?
At the body, fair?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so give us a brief update.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
I'll let him take it from here.
Thank you. Go ahead, Mike, the floor is yours.
Great, thank you. Just by way of introduction, my name's Mike Roberts. I'm an attorney with the Cohen Law Group based in Pittsburgh. We are a small law firm that specializes exclusively in assisting municipal government clients in telecommunications matters. In this instance, we are discussing specifically some amendments to the city code, not necessarily to address 5G specifically, but rather to bring the code with a few recent changes in law. So we were hired by the city back in September of 2021, both to prepare the code amendments that you have before you now, as well as to assist in the negotiation of a master license agreement with AT&T. So I'm here to give kind of some background on the ordinance project, as well as an update on that AT&T negotiation. The reason for the code amendments that we have here today is first we have a change in law at the federal level, and then subsequently we have a change in law at the state level as well. So back in 2018, actually, the FCC issued what's known as the third report in order, or colloquially known as the small cell order, which created a new type of wireless facility that is certainly being used for 5G service, but it is also used for 3G and 4G service as well. And that is known as the small wireless communications facility. So I think it's important for us to kind of take a step back here and just discuss quickly the different types of wireless communications facilities that this ordinance addresses. And it addresses really three main types of facilities. So first we have the tower-based wireless communications facility. That is your traditional cell tower. So if we all were to picture, maybe myself excluded, but if we were to picture a cell site or a cell tower, you'd likely think of a large 100-foot, 150-foot cell tower off on a hillside somewhere, a lattice-style tower. That is what the ordinance calls a tower-based wireless communications facility. We then have a non-tower wireless communications facility that will also be outside of the public rights-of-way. A good example of that would be an antenna mounted on a building rooftop or on an existing electrical tower. The gating factor there being that it is an antenna that's located on some existing structure. It does not require the construction of a new support structure. And then finally, we have the small wireless communications facility, and that's that new type of facility that was created in 2018. This is a facility that is defined strictly in a dimensional fashion. So what it is a wireless facility that is 50 feet or less in height, with an antenna that is 3 cubic feet or less in volume, and it has accessory equipment, which would be anything aside from the antenna and the pole on which the antenna is mounted, with a cumulative volume of 28 cubic feet or less. Anything that would fall at or below those dimensional levels would be considered to be a small wireless communications facility. The important thing to bear in mind here is that these facilities are most frequently located within the public rights of way. So when the FCC created these facilities back in 2018, it also imposed new restrictions on the ways that municipalities were permitted to regulate these small wireless communications facilities. And that included limitations on the fees that we are permitted to charge, both for applications as well as for use of the public rights of way. Limitations on how we are permitted to regulate the aesthetics of a facility, so how we're able to impose design restrictions. It imposed new, what we call shot clocks, which are time frames in which municipalities have to perform certain actions with respect to applications for small wireless communications facilities. And then it imposed a few additional kind of smaller regulations as well. Following that 2018 order, at the state level, there was a concerted push by the wireless industry to move forward with a state-level bill that would ultimately codify those federal requirements. That bill passed last year in June of 2021. It's known as Pennsylvania Act 50. And what Act 50 did is it codified effectively everything that I just mentioned at the federal level, while also imposing new restrictions that are specific only to small wireless communications facilities inside of the public rights of way. Chief among which is that those facilities are now required to be a permitted use in all zoning districts, subject to what is defined as applicable codes. And when I say applicable codes, I paint with a broad brush, because applicable codes means really any local ordinance or code or provisions would be in compliance with Act 50. The important thing to note with respect to these facilities is that the federal and state level regulations are very favorable for wireless providers. They reserve certain rights for municipalities, but we're only able to exercise those rights by enacting an ordinance or amending our code in the way that we have before us now. So what we're trying to do with this ordinance and these amendments is to reach out and take that authority that's been given to the city, both by the federal government as well as by the state general assembly. So initial drafts of the ordinance that we have here were provided to the city actually back in October of 2021. I have had meetings with staff to kind of go through those initial drafts, pick out any revisions or concerns that the city would have. And we've made some changes to reach the draft that you have before you now. This draft, again, is intended to address each of those three types of facilities that I mentioned, as well as to bring the code into compliance with the FCC order, as well as Act 50. The current provisions that the city does have on the books now, a number of those actually run afoul of Pennsylvania. It's critical for us to take those steps needed to bring the code into compliance with the applicable law right now. Moving into the actual text of the ordinance itself, the ordinance is crafted as a full repeal and replace of Chapter 600, Part 21, which is the city's existing wireless communications facilities section of its code. The ordinance is bulky. It's a long piece of legislation. But what it ultimately does with respect to our tower-based and our non-tower wireless communications facilities is it aims to retain most of what the city already had in place. I think what the city had in place currently was working for the city. I don't aim to come in kind of with a sledgehammer and completely rewrite things that do not need to be rewritten. But in order to facilitate the needed requirements for our small wireless communications facilities, it was necessary for us to pull out certain sections that were addressing facilities in the public way. Prior to 2018, these facilities were termed as tower-based wireless communications facilities and non-tower wireless communications facilities in the public rights of way. Given this change in definition that started with the FCC order, it was important for us to pull those existing sections out, delete them in their entirety, and replace them with a new section that would be applicable to exclusively small wireless communications facilities. In doing so, we were making so many changes to the code that a full repeal and replace was necessary in order to keep this as efficient and straightforward as possible. So the ordinance begins by simply updating the existing use tables to reflect these changes, specifically denoting where exactly each type of facility is permitted within the city and what that approval process or application process would look like, whether it be conditional use for your tower-based wireless communications facilities or permitted use for your non-tower and your small wireless communications facilities. The ordinance goes on to then establish effectively four main sections of substantive regulations. The first, which begins on page 28 of the draft that you have before you, establishes general requirements that are applicable to all wireless communications facilities. So whether tower-based, non-tower, or small wireless communications facilities, those requirements are applicable across the board. It then proceeds to address each of those potential types of facility individually. So we start with a section that is applicable exclusively to your tower-based wireless communications facilities, beginning with clarifying which districts within the city those facilities are permitted. Starting on page, 32, we allow tower-based wireless communications facilities in the CH, MC, MH, and MU zoning districts. the ordinance then establishes a clear step-by-step application process, as well as clarifying exactly which application materials are necessary for a complete application for one of these facilities. And it then goes on to impose construction requirements, operational requirements, and legal protections that are, again, applicable specifically to your tower-based wireless communications facilities. We then move to the non-tower wireless communications facilities, and that section does the same thing that the tower-based section does, hitting those same marks that are critical for us to address, which are where are the facilities located, what does that application process look like if an applicant, say Verizon, is coming and seeking to construct one of these facilities, to whom do they have to submit an application, what does that approval process look like, and what materials are needed, and again, critical design requirements, operational requirements, construction requirements, and protections. And then finally, we have the section that is the bulk of our new requirements, which begins on page 40, and that is applicable to the small wireless communications facilities specifically. Again, establishing where exactly these facilities are permitted. As I mentioned at the top of the presentation here, they are permitted use in all zoning districts, as is required by state law. Again, establishing an application process on the materials that are needed for the application, and then the relevant construction, operational, and legal protection requirements as well. The reason that the ordinance is set up the way that it is, specifically with respect to the application process, which is perhaps the most critical portion here, is that federal and state law both impose a very rigid set of rules for how we have to consider an application for one of these facilities. So I mentioned those shot clocks earlier. And federal and state law both impose distinct time frames for each of these types of facilities, for an application for each of these types of facilities. So for a small wireless communications facility, for example, we have either 60 or 90 days to act on an application that would be submitted by an entity seeking to construct one of these facilities. So on day one, when the city would receive an application, that clock begins to run. We would have 10 business days in which we would have to notify the applicant whether their application is complete or not, and request any additional materials that the city would need under the code. And then the remaining period, whether that be the 60 or 90 day total, depending on the type of facility, would be used to actually review and render a decision on that application. Because that time frame is so rigid, again, because there are clear penalties if we were to violate those timeframes, whether it be forfeiting our right to request additional information if we don't meet that initial 10 day time frame, or if we fail to meet the 60 or 90 day timeframe, having our application deemed approved and being forced to approve a facility without performing that meaningful review, it is critical for us to have very clear requirements for what materials are needed as part of an application for one of these facilities. Because when it comes time to issue a notice of incompleteness, should an application be submitted that does not include all of the materials that the city would want, we need to be able to point to an area of the code that is specifically requesting that information. So you'll see at the top of each section a list of the application materials that are needed as part of what we would consider a complete application for each type of facility. With respect to small wireless communications facilities as well, that subsection of the ordinance has a distinct kind of nuance to it with respect to how we regulate the design of those facilities. And this tends to be perhaps the most important concern for most municipalities when it comes to small wireless communications facilities, because they are located in your public rights of way. The aesthetics, the design of those facilities is important. They're close to home. We want to make sure that they are as aesthetically pleasing as possible, that we're mitigating any potential aesthetic impact. The requirements for those types of regulations are that they be objective, that they be reasonable, and that they be published in advance. So in order for us to have the ability to enforce any of those regulations, we need to hit those three benchmarks. The way that we address aesthetic regulations in the proposed ordinance here is by establishing, if we look on page 43, subsection 10, what we refer to as a small wireless communications facility design manual. So that is a separate advisory document or handbook that establishes all of the design requirements for small wireless communications facilities. And in doing so, we are ensuring first and foremost that those regulations are published as is required by federal state law. This means that an applicant needs to be able to look at those requirements prior to submitting their application. So we've spelled each of those regulations out very clearly on a very granular level, addressing regulations for the antenna component, for the accessory equipment component, for the support structure, whether it be a new structure, a replacement structure, or a facility that's going on some existing structure, such as an existing utility pole. Because again, that objectivity and that published in advance element states that we need to very clearly spell out each of those regulations. And the reason that those regulations are located kind of outside of the ordinance itself and referred to in the ordinance is to afford the city a degree of flexibility. I mentioned those shot clocks, and I'll continually refer back to those as kind of the primary rule of the road here. In order for us to respond quickly to applications, as well as to respond quickly to any changes in preference of the city. So say we were to receive an application, we were to see an installation go up and determine, you know, we actually would prefer that the accessory equipment cabinet, for example, be a different color. By placing those regulations outside of the ordinance, there's a bit more flexibility to make changes to those design requirements without having to go through a complete ordinance amendment process, go through a hearing process, and have that kind of longer time frame in which additional facilities would be applied for. So typically, the way that municipalities address that design manual is by authorizing the manual via resolution, and in that resolution, giving the authority to a staff level staffer to make changes as needed that would reflect the city's preferences there. So you'll note that you have two documents in front of you, one being the code amendments and one being that design manual. They do work in conjunction, but that design manual was again intended to afford a degree of flexibility that we would not have if we were to incorporate all of those design requirements into the language of the code itself. So again, what we're really looking to do here, if we take a broad look at this, is to establish code requirements for the city that prepare you to receive an application for any type of wireless communications facility that you could potentially see, to achieve compliance with both federal and state law, and to ensure that we are able to comply with those very critical timeframes, as well as to preserve the character of the community. There's a balance to be struck here, of course. Wireless service is crucial. It's important for your residents. It's important for your businesses. We wanna make sure that that deployment, the construction of these facilities is done in a responsible fashion, and that the city is able to express its preferences and address any concerns that you would have with respect to this deployment. So that kind of covers the ordinance portion. I mentioned that there's an AT&T license agreement negotiation as well. But before that's kind of a brief discussion. So before we dive into that, I'm happy to address any questions that anyone would have regarding the drafts.
Thank you, Mike. Does anyone have any questions or comments for Mike? Marcia.
Okay. An overview, and I believe this absolutely must happen if we're going to remain competitive with any kind of economic development. You have a 5G network. Is it am I correct that most of these facilities won't be the large cell towers we're familiar with, but would rather be the smaller transmitting stations located in different places throughout the city?
That's correct. To clarify kind of the operation of each of these facilities as briefly as I possibly can, your large cell towers, so your tower-based facilities and your non-tower facilities, those are used primarily to address gaps in coverage, so areas where there is not currently cell service, right? your small wireless communications facilities, which are really what you're referring to, address gaps in capacity. So areas where the demand is so high, your residential areas, your central business districts, areas near office buildings, hospitals, things like that, where so many users are using the existing facilities that it's slowing the speeds down, small wireless communications facilities are deployed on a more targeted basis to boost that capacity. Most providers, you see their commercials on TV where they claim 99% coverage nationally. Coverage isn't really so much of an issue, certainly in a place like the city. So yes, the capacity issues will be what providers will be looking to address, likely moving forward, which would be those small wireless facilities. Again, typically they will be public rights of way. That's a far more attractive area for providers to deploy, given those regulations at the federal and state level. We do see them outside the public rights of way occasionally, but for the most part, they'll be in your public rights of way.
Anyone else? No? All right, thank you, Michael, so much for your thorough presentation. When will this be on for voting?
That's a good question. I mean, I think unless there's input, I think we'll give you guys a little bit more on that, but we probably look at it in maybe the first meeting in September.
Okay, thank you. All right, thank you. So we're going to move on to the next item on our agenda. And the next item is review of ARPA recommendations. So I understand there are members in the audience who are applicants. I just want to make you aware that during the Committee of the Whole, we don't accept public comments. However, during our public hearing later this evening, ARPA recommendations are an item on the agenda. And at that point, you're welcome. You're allowed up to 5 minutes because it's an agenda item to say a few words, and you can sign up at the podium to do so. Just wanted to make sure I made that clear. If you haven't already registered. Thank you, Linda. Marcia, did you have something to say? Go ahead, Marcia.
Yes, I think it's just very important for us to be publicly stating how we're gonna make the decisions to all the applicants, some of her different information from different individuals. And so I think as we get into our ARPA discussion, we just all have to come to a consensus about what this review process is like, how we're going to be coming to the matrix, and that the applicants know that everyone has a fair and equitable access to scoring. And then later in the discussion, I'm going to add some recommendations that I feel that may be helpful to the whole pool of applicants. I just think that this is something that our decision shouldn't be swayed either way. We're reviewing what the applicants put in writing, okay? What they presented, application. The normal process is what's followed by governments when they make decisions about funding. So it would be similar to if we had an applicant that had put in a bid for a public works project and came in and presented to council, this is what my proposal is, when the administration was coming forward with the recommendation. So I just wanted to make sure that, and I'm hopeful my fellow council members are agreeing with me on what that process needs to look like. Thank you.
And I think it merits explaining what the process was and where we're at in the process. Donna, did you want to add something? Go ahead.
And talking about the process, I think the process has been, and I'm being generous in saying this, very flawed. And it's unclear to all the applicants that they all get a fair shake, because I'm looking at my notes from what we did at the ARPA review committee and results, and things changed midway through in terms of the amounts and how we were doing things. And I'm not even comfortable with that committee. And then suddenly we get the mayor's recommendations. I just don't think it's fair to the applicants. So I think we need to really, as a council, and I think Melissa, you've been pretty clear about that, and I appreciate your concerns and dovetailing on those, that everybody gets equal treatment. Melissa was very consistent about that. I agree with her on that, I agree with Marcia. I think it's just been a very, very, and I'm sorry for the applicants, that it's been a very, very flawed process. And I apologize, at least as a sitting member of council for that happening, but let's make sure we coalesce an agreement on how we're going to go from here so everyone gets an absolutely fair shake. Melissa, I think I appreciate your thoughts.
Did you need to add anything, Melissa? And just for clarity to the public, just an effort to be clear and transparent, obviously we received ARPA dollars, $61 million, how long ago? Here, right? And obviously we've had a change in leadership.
Oh, I'm sorry. Half Marie. Of the money was received last year and half of the money was received this year, just in like in June or July.
Thank you, Maria, for the clarity. Obviously, we had a change in leadership and in terms of process. You know, we've had several changes. Right? And I want to say the instructions on how to proceed and how to go about processing applicants. We ran into some obstacles, concerns, into some challenges. So in an effort to be fair, equitable, and give every applicant a fair shot at receiving funding, we want to review the process again. We want to go through each application. And also we are adding an additional committee of the whole meeting this Wednesday, the day after tomorrow, the 10th, to give organizations at least 15 minutes because we do have specific questions based on the application submitted. There was a review committee established. The make of the review committee consisted of members of administration, members of council, and a member from the community. There were about four sessions held where applications were reviewed. I think some organizations had to present, but we want to make sure.
Go ahead, Donna. Did, and therein was the inequity with the other organizations.
Right, so I was getting to that.
It was flawed.
Even concerns with even how we were scoring, right? Because organizations, some are relatively new, some have been years in experience, there's different needs. And again, in an effort for us to make sound decisions that were fair and equitable to everyone who applied, we wanna, I guess, address some of those concerns. And instead of starting from scratch, give opportunities to some of these applicants to resubmit, as Marsha pointed out, maybe update and add to their financial use of the ARPA dollars. Is that a fair way of describing? Yes, Donna.
So let's make sure whatever we're asking is a uniform formatted ask and can fill that out equally. Standpoint. Marsha, you talked a little bit more about that.
Thank you, Councilwoman. Thank you, Council President. Thank you for your condolences. I want to just publicly thank the council body. I couldn't be here last week for considering to have these dialogues, have these discussions. I know that I respect very dearly the process that took place, or at least what was given to the committee and what they had to work for. So I appreciate the recommendations that were afforded or extended rather. Based on what they were giving. However, I don't want us to get lost. The fact that ARPA stands for American Rescue Plan Act. And that's why I thank the council body for willing to discuss it further and accept some of the recommendations that I move forward so that organizations that either have been challenged by loss of revenue or services that they could extend additionally through the American Rescue Plan Act benefit from. So just wanted to publicly say thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. And again, you know, I thank every organization for their service to our community because it's important to acknowledge and recognize the efforts put forward. And as you mentioned, ARPA dollars is to support what these organizations are doing for our community. So point well taken. Thank you for highlighting. So I want to be, yes, Marsha, you have something to say? Go ahead.
Yeah, and I think some comments have been made about the application process, but just from a committee member's perspective, we were provided with a rubric to use to score applications from all different types of applicants, from ones that had been existing, strong established nonprofits, to the grassroots types of organizations. And it isn't fair in a review process to be able to compare those two, because of course, if you're there's going to be difference in capacity. So I'm hoping so discussing tonight as we move on to Wednesday is going to help give everyone a level playing field and help to bring up those have a good project but may not have demonstrated strong areas in budget and capacity. And I believe there's a way to do that. Part of that relies on us as a city and with our contracted consultant is to give support and technical assistance to those organizations. So in the long run, the city is responsible for the utilization of those funds. So we want to make sure that every applicant has the capacity to deliver that they're proposing in the way that they're proposing that follows budgetary guidelines. That being said, what I noted in the application process is I didn't see a consistent budgetary document coming to the applicants. So I want to turn this back to the city to say, we need to provide that for the applicants, a budgetary document that is simple to describe, that contains all the line items that we would be reimbursing those applicants for. By doing that then, when we receive invoices, we can compare what's being proposed what we're invoicing and make sound determinations as far as funding. That's the only way to work. And then if groups need assistance along the way, that's what either the city or its consultant agency is there to provide. That's the way it's happened in my work experience all along the line from all different state, federal funding sources, that you're there to support the ideas and to make them come to fruition, making sure that all the fiscal guidelines are followed and the programs are delivered as proposed. Thank you.
Mayor, before you go on, if I may say something. Now, I don't want to put anyone on the spot, but did everyone have a chance to look and I'm talking about those that weren't necessarily on the committee, because I know the committee did their extensive work. You've read through every single proposal, financials, and so on. I know I made time to go through every single one. Some of us even got together and we're going through stuff and we made phone calls and things of the sort. Because there, as you mentioned, Marsha, there are some established organizations that provided details in terms of revenue, for example. And whereas there's some organizations that are requesting money for certain projects and in general expenses of what they intend to do with the upper. So there's a distinction. So for us, to ask the administration to provide specific line items, it may not always be applicable to every organization, huh? Well, what I'm saying is that there's some organizations that are requesting to replace loss of revenue and they've provided financial statements expressing that. Then you have organizations that are specifically requesting dollars for specific projects and then they've provided a breakdown of how they're gonna spend those dollars. So I'm not sure, and administration, please feel free to answer that, if one in or one format would suit every applicant in every organization. I don't know if one size would fit this. Yeah.
I want to be very respectful with my comments, right? As I always are. I don't know, to answer your question in short, I don't know if that's the case. However, I will say that, I hope it, as far as the administration is concerned, and that we had hired a consultant and we had set forward a committee that we had hoped would get all those details, get those information. We're running short on time. We could potentially lose some of these fundings if we do not disperse them accordingly. Now, in regards to how we manage them, we have to be very careful. There's a fine line there, at least for me, my understanding, I don't know. Solicitor, please correct me, and Mr. Finance Director, but there's a fine line how we micromanage whenever it's given. There are institutions, there are protocols, rules and regulations from the federal government and state government that monitors those applicants that receive funding that we could always revoke if they do not use them accordingly. So I'm just a little concerned that we put so much regulations on management of how the money is being spent that we don't have the proper staffing and maybe we're out of line from doing that. There are civic organizations and federal institutions that monitor how recipients of grants utilize those funds. We've seen it, where we have to be mindful of the time to disperse the money and how much speculation on micromanagement.
Donna.
Looking at my August 2021, when this was first brought to us, we have till the end of 2024 to commit and 2026 to spend funds, so there is time. And this was what was presented to us when the $61 million was announced by former Managing Director Almaros and going forward from there. So we have time.
Jamar?
So I know we have a lot of time. 2022 is already almost over. We do not have as much time as it would appear. Also, the extent to which it takes a long time to get agreement on and get it approved through the process of council is also going to contribute to our inability to spend this money and the amount of time that's been given. On the issue of compliance with our grant requirements, as I explained before, it is not possible to do one cookie cutter approach to funding. Some will need to be reimbursable. Some will need to be an upfront lump sum. We can require either monthly or quarterly reporting on the expenditures to make sure that the organizations are in compliance. And that's more staff time that's required. And respectfully, we're headed into budget season and there's like two people working on this, me and my assistant. So have people working on this to add more layers to the process, respectfully.
Chris?
I just have a quick question. Who is it that the entity that receives the funds ultimately reports to? Do they report to the federal government or do they report to us and then we report on their behalf that everything was good? How does that work?
They report to us. So this is a city grant under ARPA funding. Okay, it'll be classified in our report to the federal government as a lost revenue program. So 32 or however many organizations are funded will report to us, and that information will go into our annual external audit that is filed.
So just to follow up on that then, and it really would never ever happen, but I'm just trying to explore possibilities. If there was a breakdown in, like, you know, we gave to someone and it wasn't above board, it would come back on the city or it would come back on them?
You're saying if we suspect something,
say we don't even suspect, say it's just a total misunderstanding. Nobody's really, it's nothing on purpose. Who ultimately has the liability in that? Is it the city or is it the individual entity?
So again, my understanding, and please forgive me if I'm ignorant in answering this, but if a 501 receive a grant, they are responsible to utilize the funding according to the 501c3 rules and regulations. If they do wrong, they have the potential of losing that grant or getting that grant taken back, and even possibly so federal penalties.
My question says they are reporting to us, though. They are not directly reporting, at least in terms of those dollars, to the federal government.
So in terms of grant compliance, they are reporting to us. In terms of the federal government and their 501 status, they will...
I'm sorry.
I'm trying to answer your question.
Yeah, I know.
They will report revenue received, and that will go into their 990 filing with the IRS.
Okay. All right.
Marsha?
And I heard different verbiage, and I know we all come from a different perspective. I don't look at micromanagement at all occurring. I'm not even sure I understand how that would apply. I look at management occurring, and I understand capacity of staff, and I believe that's why we brought on the consultant, okay? I believe quarterly invoices are acceptable, and it's just a matter of assisting those groups as they come through the beginning stages of their process, that they may need just assistance on, these are my expenses, how do the invoices prepared? That's to help strengthen them, because one of the questions we're also looking at was sustainability. This ARPA funding is a one-time funding. These groups may want to continue to exist beyond ARPA. The best way that we can help them, besides providing funding, is to help them build their capacity so that they can move on to the next step. So that's what I see as part of this process. The other thing is, when we talk about line items, maybe I needed to be more explicit about, I agree with a comment that was made that there may be a different budget form when we're looking at loss of revenue, or when we're looking at capital items, and when we're looking at other kinds of operating expenses. Operating expenses meaning salaries, benefits, supplies, rent, that type of thing. And so we want to help the groups to be able to understand what are their goals. And then I think one of the crux to this, when we talk about timeline, by the way, this should not take an extraordinary amount of time. If we let the groups know what's expected of them after our meeting on Wednesday, and we give them a quick timeline to turn around and work with the administration, we should be able to move forward. It just looks at some of maybe challenges with capacity. They just need to be asking for help. But getting back to what we look at as far as moving ahead with the amounts of dollar, be realistic about what your budget is based on and whether you can draw down that amount of money. When I looked at some of the recommendations for funding with my experience in working with nonprofit grants, I thought this sounded like a large amount of money for a small nonprofit to pull down. Not that they didn't have good ideas, but just the amount of money. And I think people need to start small and not plan really big. Start small, be successful. That builds their capacity to move on. So that's just some of my thoughts as I'm gonna be looking at these proposals.
Council President.
Thank you, Marsha. Yes, Mayor.
I just want to bring clarification. I don't want my misusage of language, perhaps, bring more confusion than needed. When I mentioned micromanagement, I was just referring to, yes, we should be holding everybody accountable as elected officials of a constituency. However, what I meant was that if they have to report their 990s to the federal government, you know, we just have to be careful much reports we evaluate on their behalf, but not to say that there's a free for all, you know, absolutely not. I just want to make sure I clear myself from my previous comments. Thank you, Councilwoman.
And also, yes, Maria. A comment I just want to make. We just had to make sure that the administration followed the federal government guidelines and all the documentation that is needed for any audit in the future is maintained, that the city maintain all the proper documentation, because we have to make sure we have the documentation for any audit that could be done by the federal government.
Thank you. So just for purposes of how do we proceed? So tonight it's on our agenda for as a new introduction. Wednesday, we're inviting organizations to give us 15 minutes of their time to fix questions, because I believe the entire body has reviewed every application and financial finances and so on, and we have our set of questions, right? Size moment. I just want to make clear that out of the 32 applications, we eliminated the for-profits and we chose to focus on nonprofits, because I want to make that clear, right? We also, am I correct? For process of elimination purposes, only focused on city entities. So any applicant that submitted an application and does not, and their organization does not reside in the city, they were eliminated from the list. So in total, we have 26 applications. My question to the body, because I know that as we, some of us either individually or in twos or in threes, discussed, or even for the review committee, looked at the applications. I think we were all in favor of, because they met every single requirement. Correct or wrong? I just want to understand. We had some consensus around some of the organizations, right? So at this point, and I'm going to look to legal, would it be safe? We can go down the list of organization and say while they are on either the review committee recommendation or the mayor's recommendation, because the ones that I'm going to mention are on tonight's agenda. Can we state that these are the ones that we need to come in on Wednesday for additional information? I'm looking also at the body, right? Are we on the same page? Okay. So is it safe for me to do so at this time? We'll go one organization by organization and say, we need them to come in Wednesday. Yes or no?
Wait, are you asking if all of the applicants that you have, except for the ones that you've eliminated, for them to come in Wednesday, or are you just saying only the ones that there's not a consensus already for?
The ones that are not a consensus. But again, I don't think that we, as a group and as a body, decided. I think in conversations, we make decisions as to who were we in favor of or who we had consensus around. And again, in favor because they eligibility requirement, they were very clear on the application, and they provided financial statements.
I mean, I guess I would just suggest consistency. You should still invite everyone, even if you feel there's a level of consensus already.
Okay, just want to make sure we're... All right, so then at this point, does it even make sense for me to go through every organization? No.
Jahani, just so we're all cognizant, 15 minutes at 32 applicants, just everybody to camp.
Have our sleeping bags here.
Well, didn't we just say we do all 32?
That we would invite them, but
we would invite them.
Not necessarily.
Yeah, I mean,
questions.
Okay.
Right.
Just for clarity, out of the 32 applications, only 26 were considered because the other six meet the city requirement in terms of where their organization resides.
Was that criteria part of what the consultant put together, or did you just decide that as internal? I mean, I would say you should still extend the invitation. At the end of the day, I think it's already been made public what the understanding is with respect to that criteria, though. So it's up to them if they want to attend or not.
Chris?
And I would just offer, we need to communicate to these organizations that, at least in my mind, I don't know if that we have consensus on this, but that it's not so much a presentation of exactly what they presented, but answering the questions specific that we have. Because that's how, otherwise, that's not going to be 15 minutes. That's going to be an hour and a half per. Right. So I know many of us likely have very specific questions that are answerable in 30 seconds.
Jahani,
Marcia?
I'm just trying to look at the logistics here. And to be fair to the applicants too, is that if you look at 15 minutes for 26 applicants, that's 6.5 hours. Okay. So to be able to say that it's a long night, we all know that our decision-making is not as robust when it gets at the end of a long night. And to be fair to the applicants, we can't have every one of them come in at the same time and be able to be waiting for the process. So we have to figure out better how we're going to schedule this. And I agree that it may only take a couple minutes, but if we're scheduling them in 15-minute periods of time, it is as far as the amount.
Frank?
When is the meeting going to start on Wednesday? I know we're had some emails going back and forth because there's a flag raising ceremony, Ecuadorian flag 5. Now it's till 6. It's till 6 o'clock. That doesn't mean we have to wait till 6. But I
advertised it for 5:30.
Got okay. 5:30. Got it.
5:30.
Okay. So then,
thank you.
Thanks.
That's a good compromise. Thank you.
Got it.
Yes, Jamar.
Perhaps instead of 15 minutes, maybe 5, max 10.
Fair. And then we can decide to extend or not, right? Perfect. Someone else?
Do you have questions for each organization?
Not necessarily. But we want to extend the invitation to all organizations to make it fair.
I guess I wonder, thinking like an organization, I think I would want a heads up if I'm going to be one of the ones question. So maybe if we let them know in advance which ones we think are called upon to answer questions, that might be a little better.
I mean, if I could suggest too, I mean, if you're going to have them attend, you should give them an opportunity to at least give a wish, you know, for their request, even if you don't have any specific questions for them. I mean, the pitch shouldn't be more than 90 seconds. No. Right, right.
Okay.
Okay, so then at this point, all applicants will be invited.
And I have no problem.
Will the administration be able to assist in helping invite organizations? Okay, or are you able to provide our city clerk's office with contact information?
Everyone today.
Well, since we're calling the session, I would like, we can share the responsibility. Calling the session, we're inviting because we've had recommendations from the committee and the mayor's office. So if we can have a combined and collaborative effort into reaching to the applicant, things more so we can divide and conquer.
Exactly. I would say that respectfully that this is a council agenda that is being discussed further. I don't want to be put in the middle as far as the administration is concerned. We'll be more than happy to assist in any given way, but I don't want it to be a responsibility of administration on a council agenda. Announcement. Now, I'm just need a little bit of clarification. So are they still being introduced as a block today with the recommendations of the ones that were from the committee in addition to my additional recommendation? Are they still going to be introduced as a block?
They're all being introduced, but since we have 2-week time frame to vote on, I want to make sure we have adequate information to make the decisions.
Thank you.
Council President, if we're going to make the calls, we're going to, could somebody create a script for us? Because we want to make sure when we make the call, exactly what the applicant needs prepared to do. Well, we do. We can email, but we got to be very specific of what we're asking.
No, but then we're not doing that.
Well,
we're not.
Oh, you just want the email address. So you're going to handle it.
Most don't have email addresses.
Okay.
No.
All right. Yeah.
We need. We're clear. We're good. Donna, go ahead.
What we're introducing today is 25. So if we're asking everyone to come in, then their organizations are already excluded from these ordinances. And how do we then justify that? Do we amend the ordinances introduced tonight with those other organizations? That's my question to the body.
No, you're right. And that's why if Mike Gumbar can answer that for us, please.
So if you're going to be amending the ordinance to add new entities, then I think you may need to do a new ordinance. If you're just going to eliminate some or adjust the dollar amounts, then that's an amendment you can make at the council meeting when we're voting.
Just for clarity, Chris, before you go, at our last conversation and discussion, we did narrow it down. This is why we said we're going to have these introduced at tonight's meeting. So we want to invite all of those to come and attend because some had already been excluded from, they weren't recommended by the committee and they weren't recommended by the mayor's office. So could we proceed based on what's on those organizations that are on tonight's agenda? Yes, Marcia.
Yeah, and I was just going to clarify, as I review tonight's agenda, the ones that were eliminated are not on the agenda, if I'm correct. So they weren't put on the agenda because somewhere early in the process, they were eliminated.
And for clarity, there's 25 that made it, not 26. So only those 25 will be invited, correct?
That's fine. That's you have a consensus for that, and there's going to be no objection as far as those 9 entities that were excluded. I don't see a reason why to waste both parties' times.
Thank you for the clarity. All right, so then I think it, yes, Marcia.
I'm just trying to get into the details here, but I think it's important for the organizations. Do we want to set a time frame as we're contacting them? So we now it's sort of coming to a 2-hour period. Do we want all of them to be sitting through the 2-hour period, even though they might be last? Or do we want to say a certain group comes between 5:30 and 6:30, another group comes between 6:30 and 7:30? Just thoughts being received.
Yeah,
Chris,
I certainly understand that. I think with it's since we've narrowed it down to likely a 2-hour situation, I don't think it's too much to ask given the amounts of monies that we're talking about to sit through a little bit.
And then just to be clear, since council is requesting the additional meeting, then Jamar can. Or clerk's office, whoever, the contact information, right? Yes, we're receiving contact information and we're taking it from there. Thank you. Okay, so I don't think we need any more discussion regarding ARPA. For those organizations that are already here and that are scheduled to speak, you expect or anticipate a phone call, or if not, you've been notified. Tomorrow, Wednesday, August 10th, we're allocating time from, you will be emailed. We're allocating time on Wednesday, August 10th, from 5:30 to 7:30 to ask very specific questions to each organization. We still welcome your 5 minutes of input or comment during our public hearing meeting. So I just want to make sure that we're clear on that. You want to, why?
I'm glad to always see people here, but were you asked to be here? By council or by the...
Our public hearing meetings are open to the public, and if you are on the agenda or if you have a comment or concern regarding an agenda item, you are given, provided up to 5 minutes.
Yeah, can I just want to
absolutely
make sure that, you know, we acknowledge organizations as it's our duty to recognize constituencies as well as organizations that an agenda item was being talked on their behalf, and they're more than willing, as it is their house, to share a few words if they wish to. They don't have to. We did not request for anybody to come speak. We just simply acknowledge that an agenda item speaking on their behalf was being introduced, and they are free to share if they like. So I just wanted to make clear that the administration did not request for people to speak. That's on the here from today's meeting that council is going to make that request, correct?
Mayor, with all due respect, the administration is entitled to ask, inform,
yeah, of course.
Just
exactly.
Like council exactly. Is. So these are public meetings. Exactly. Everyone is welcome to attend, listen. During our public meetings, everyone is welcome to make a comment, have a concern. They're given either 3 minutes or 5 minutes. So you don't have to explain. If you asked them to attend, thank you. We welcome you to be here. If you didn't, if we asked, everyone is always welcome to attend our meetings. And if you have a concern, comment, or question, this, right? Thank you. Yes, Marcia.
And I appreciate what's being said about this being public meetings, and that's certainly recognizable and acceptable. However, whenever there's an RFP process, a request for proposal, this is normally not the way that it's handled. Both the administration, and I look at what goes on at the state level, legislative body work together, and there's a process set up for evaluation. That being made, I welcome input from citizens. However, the council must stick to its review process, which does not include public comment tonight. We are reviewing these based on the applications we received, and the questions are going to be related to that. So I don't want to mislead people that are speaking tonight to believe that by speaking tonight, it has something to do with how we evaluate the proposals. They're two separate things.
Minister, for clarity or legal, is this an or a city grant? I just, or this, please define what this is.
This is a city grant program. This is not an RFP. This is a city grant program. That's it.
And then again, I'm going to ask, what is the process for all city grants?
This is the first time we've done this.
Okay.
We have filed the experience county very, very closely. We've been in close coordination to figure out what they're doing and tailored our process after theirs to the greatest extent practical and possible.
And then just for fairness, did we reach out to every single ARPA applicant that made it on tonight's agenda, or did we select who we invited or informed?
Again, we made everyone that could be made aware that there was a meeting today.
And that was every single applicant. Sorry? Every single applicant. All of the 32.
Every single applicant that made it to the and were considered as by the committee as well. So there was a committee that was set up. They made some recommendations, acknowledged as well as, you know, the mayor is recommending, that were seemed qualified according to this regulations, but by our consulting. Is that your answer, Councilwoman?
Yes, and do you have a document that shows all the ones that were contacted and how they were contacted?
Again,
were they contacted by a phone? Were they individually invited?
Again,
going every single one on here?
Again, everyone that we could potentially reach out to, acknowledging that there's a public meeting we did.
Was that done by email or by phone?
By phone.
And that was done with council staff?
But again,
staff, or
I think we're losing the fact that we invited people to the house to listen to a potential item that they may have an interest in. This wasn't a request to come and share or mandate to share for an appeal to funding. That is being done by council, that is being done by the committee, that's being done by the consultants. There's an agenda item that was appeared and the council that we notify individuals that they have been named in this agenda item. And they're more than welcome to show up and speak if they feel free. But however, after today's discussion, it appears that council now has a new way moving forward with the considerations. And maybe you want to share that before the meeting begins, so in case that somebody wants to withdraw from speaking tonight.
Be very clear, and if I can speak on behalf of council, obviously I want to reiterate and stress, we want this process to be very and very equitable. So everyone has an opportunity to explain themselves, explain their request for funding, how it's going to be utilized, so that we all, because we all have great intentions, right? And we want to support the work that our organizations provide to our constituents, but we just want to make sure that the process is fair, equitable, clear, transparent. So I think in an effort to do so is why we are extending the process, if you will. Now, 25 applications are on the agenda to be introduced. Therefore, this evening, you have whoever's here, whoever signed up in advance, has up to 5 minutes to speak. On Wednesday, all 25 are invited from 5:30 p.m. on, because we, the body, have additional questions, because some of the applications left us with concerns and we need clarity so that we can move forward when it comes time to vote on agenda items. Have I made that clear, Council? Yes, Marcia.
And I want to make myself very clear too, and I do believe I have some support from my members. What we hear tonight at this public input, in no way way influences our decision on what we do on Wednesday night, because this is unprecedented. And Mayor, I know you wanted to look at, is it a grant or request for a proposal? It doesn't matter. It's using public dollars. And when you do that in an equitable, balanced way. We set up a process with the review committee that we all agreed was not the best. We then set up a process for Wednesday night. I am certainly very interested in what all these good groups do, but in no way for myself is going to weigh in on how I scored them according to the way the proposals were presented, asking them for the future, okay? The process happens on Wednesday night. Tonight, we're going to be informed of a lot of good intentions, but Wednesday night is really the important time to notify people, okay? So I'm glad we're at least getting back on track. You know, I shared this with both council president and some other council members. If the process got back on track, I would have voted, not because they weren't good organizations, but because in my conscience, as far as an equitable process, I couldn't have supported any allocations. Now that we're back on track, I'm really open to that. But before that, I was feeling this thing got really the track. So let's get it back on track the right way. And let's all make good decisions based on what people say to us on Wednesday night. Thank you.
Anyone else have any additional comments? Ask Linda.
Okay. So just for clarity, I'm going to invite all 25 to first make a 90-second pitch about their application and then inform them that there may be questions.
Yes.
Okay. And second, yes. Do you want to talk about the special meeting?
For ARPA.
Yeah.
We should speak to, yes. So one of the things that Linda had recommended as it relates to ARPA specific, being that there are 25, and I think some members of council wanted to go one by one versus group, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that we allocate a special meeting just for ARPA that's separate and apart from our regular council business matters. So I wanted to look around the room and I want to know, since so that ARPA specific voting happens on a separate day than our regular second and fourth Monday public meetings. I see nods. Is anyone opposed? I guess I should ask. All right, so yes, we have to identify the date.
Jahani, I still have a question about the scoring as we do that after we, well, two things, the scoring process, so we're all on the same page about that, but also as we ask the questions and what we expect of the 25 folks, organizations coming in, that we agree on those questions, that those questions are uniform to the applicants. Was that not what we were going for? So we were being equitable to everyone?
So you're asking about uniformed questions. So depending...
Same criteria is presented to us as uniformly as possible so that we can then score and have that rubric.
I think our roadblock is that the application... So I think we discussed this at the last meeting, whereas there are some applicants that are requesting, that are reporting on loss of revenue. Then we have organizations that are requesting funds for capital improvement, some from for infrastructure, some for social services. So they were, and we talked about this. How do we, should we, do we lump it, right? So I think depending on which, and I don't know if we define now, because then that would allow us more uniform questioning depending on the category. Go ahead, Chris.
The thing I see with uniform questioning is that their proposal, some of the proposals lacked specific things that others included. I don't want to have to ask a question that I already know the answer to, you know what I mean?
That makes sense. Also, you're right. Marsha, did you want to add something?
It was a question for the administration, because one of the questions I could see is that we would be asking for a revised budget. Will you have those forms to be able to get out to the applicants if that's being requested? Well, actually, it needs to be requested for all of them, because I'm not sure they all did uniform budgets. some of them had a lot more detailed budget information, but it wasn't uniform, if you know what I mean. And I can walk through them with you individually, Jamar, but I was looking for a certain type of budgetary form that I was accustomed to seeing in reviewing proposals. And I saw things that talked about lost revenue, but I didn't see a uniform budget form.
If you want to document, I'm happy to look it over and create a template based off of that. But we did not issue a template in the application packet that went out back in May.
Okay.
Anyone else? All right, so we're gonna go ahead and move. Are we clear then on the next steps? Just wanna make sure. So no, we don't have unified questions. We're gonna be compiling questions individually. I suppose, I think we should probably send those, we should internally send those questions, because if Chris and I have the same question for one organization, then, right? You know, Marsha may have the same question, Donna may have the same question. I don't know, but perhaps that's something we should discuss internally and compile a list. Make sense or no?
If you, because I do, after you ask it, I won't.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So I think it'll be all right. Sure. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
All right. All right, so we're going to proceed then, and we're going to move on to agenda review so that we can start our working on. All right, so we have invocation by Reverend Jeremiah Sassaman from St. Paul's Lutheran Church. Will he be virtual or in person?
I'm unsure, but I think he'll be
virtual. Okay. All right, then under proclamations and presentations, we have Chris Daubert. Are you presenting for National Health Center Week? Is this for today, Linda?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So we have zero on here. Now, at what point are we swearing in Mr. Miller? Okay. So we get Chris Miller under oath. Awesome. All right. And then how many public comments? How many people do we have signed up for public comments? And did we look at the podium by chance? And we could still, people can still sign up until we start our meeting. So we have a total of 20, potentially 20 plus. Okay. Okay, then we move on to approval of I noticed something on the agenda when I looked over new ordinances, and we have the ARPA review committee recommendations and the mayor's additional recommendations. There are two organizations that are missing from the review committee recommendations that were listed under the mayor's recommendation. And those are the Million Youth Chess Club and the Olivet Boys and Girls Club. They need to be bumped up to reflect 9 and 10 of the review committee recommendations. 9 and 10. All right, so moving along, I'm gonna go on straight to consent agenda. So we have a word of contract for the purchase of 1 6-set drying unit from Pack Industries in Harrisburg, PA in the amount of $11,795. Budget. Pack Industries is a PA CoStars vendor, and the purchase is reflective of the CoStars pricing. The drying unit will be placed at the Reading Hose Fire Station located at 4th Franklin Street for drying of firefighters' personal protective equipment in accordance with the National Fire Protection Association standard NFPA 1851 standard on selection, care, and maintenance of protective ensembles for structural firefighting and proximity firefighting. Anyone have questions on that? And if you read the attachments, it's pretty self-explanatory. All right, moving on, award of contract to Overhead Door, Reading, PA, in $7,400 from Capital Relations, all public work garages. The project is to repair and or replace weather seals on the public work garage doors, which will promote heat retention in the winter, as well as prevent other weather infiltration to all public work garage bays. Questions on that one? Moving on.
Excuse me.
Yes, Maria.
That money is coming out of the capital budget or the ARPA money?
It says from capital. From capital.
Okay. Thank you.
The next one is for award of contract for a Co-Star based a plum and Franklin fire station roof to Sensenig Company of Ephrata in the amount of $171,660 from the capital budget. Questions on that one? Some other bids attached, and this one made it, so I saw that. All right, award of contract for school crossing guards to All City Management Services, Inc., California, at the submitted price not to exceed $634,077. This company will be responsible for providing crossing guards at 40 locations specified by the city and or school district. Crossing guard program is funded in a 50-50 split with the Reading School District. The proposal includes field supervision and the possibility of substitutes. It also includes orientation, training, recruitment, and staffing. The contractor shall provide the city with proof of certification training upon request, must provide drug screenings and criminal background checks. Crossing guards must be required to obtain their child abuse clearance through the state of PA and must be renewed every 3 years. The contractor shall provide experienced field supervisors that oversee the operations at all times. The contractor shall provide 24-hour answering service. The current school crossing guards must be given an opportunity to seek employment with the new contractor. Should the contractor decide to not select any of the current school guards, a written report should be sent to the police department designee explaining the reasons. Do we have questions or comments regarding this one? Marcia?
Okay, it's good. Okay. Having received some inquiries from our present crossing guards wanting to know what was happening, because knowing school year is coming, and because this is on the consent agenda and therefore may not receive the opportunity for comment, I would like it to be put on the regular agenda just so comments can be made. This is a major change for changing from neighborhood residents crossing guards who have been serving our citizens and our children for years. So I think it's good for us to at least have it on. So I see I may be getting some agreement if you wouldn't mind, Johanny.
Come.
What was that, Marcia?
We would move it to resolution.
Right. Under. Yep. Agree. Any other comments regarding that one?
Can I clarify? So the crossing guards are still going to be residents from the neighborhoods.
Right.
We're not importing any crossing guards from outside the city. That's not our expectation.
And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to be moved from the consent agenda and moved on to the regular agenda so we can have that discussion. Thanks.
And yes, Maria, go ahead.
Did the school district agree to pay their share, like half of this, like the same way they did it in the past?
That's not going to change. Just to be clear, this has been talked about for many years. Mm-hmm. We're finally acting on it and good, making sure that we have a better complement, better being closer to the budgeted number of 47 locations than the number of locations that we were able to staff this past year. We did reach out to the school district to let them know that we were engaging in this effort, and they said thank you.
And just for clarity, those 47 were identified and agreed upon by both parties, right?
Of course.
Okay.
And thank you, that 47 has been reduced from a much higher number prior to that.
Thank you, Yamar. I just want to make sure it is the same.
And then just for additional clarity, it's half of that amount. Usually we bill to get reimbursed.
So we bill for quarterly reimbursement from the school, which means there is a lag. So in next year's budget, you will see the full $630,000 on our expense side, but we still have agreement from the school district for 50% reimbursement of total costs.
Thank you, Jamar. Anyone else? Melissa? My only comment was thank you to the administration for finally moving forward with this. This was a major concern for me. Living in the city where there's the high school right there and then middle school, elementary, and a lot of people not stopping at the stop sign and kids scared to cross. So just hopefully these all get filled for this school year. Thank you.
We can't make any guarantees, of course, but this company, this is the only space that they work in. So they're much more adept at finding. We may have been admittedly struggling to find. It'll also traffic officers to do more traffic enforcement instead of crossing guard supervision, respectfully.
And then lastly, I noticed that they're a business located in California. Do they have satellite offices here?
They have multiple municipalities that they staff in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
Thank you.
And the we had put this out to bid earlier in the summer because of vacation and all that fun stuff. We didn't get responses initially, which is why we had to rebid it, and we're coming up on a timing crunch. But in the bids that we did receive, we reached out to all of those to make sure that they would be operable by the first day of school. And that part was guaranteed. So we should be good to go with the award of contract tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, that moves on. Administrative report, Mayor and Frank will be delivering. Then we have report from Office of the Auditor. Maria will be reporting on that. And then we have a report from the Reading Public Library Board. Will they be joining us virtually or in person, Linda? In person, great. Then we have ordinances for final passage. We have one here that is under pending legislation. Mike.
Yeah, so I think that one is the subject of an upcoming Committee of the Whole meeting for final review. So this Monday, yeah, next Monday, right? So no action would be taken on it tonight.
So then we will, I'll read it into record, and then we'll need that one to be motioned to tabled, correct? Do I need to read it? I thought I read it last time.
Yeah, I was mistaken on the prior practice that we used with the pending legislation box. Yeah, so it's been tabled once, so that should be good until.
So no need to read it into record. It's on the agenda and it will be discussed.
Not until you're ready to act again.
Perfect. Good. Thank you. All right, so that takes me to Bill 72-2022, amending City Code Section 5-207 relating to the attendance solicitor and city council at council meetings. That was introduced at July 25th regular meeting. Any comments, questions? Did that bill make sense to everyone?
Yeah, so that was just to clarify the ordinances only identified the city solicitor as being necessary for attendance at a meeting. So we just beefed that up to include the city council solicitor position now as well too.
Thank you, Mike. The next bill, 73-2022, authorizing an appropriations transfer in the amount of $200,000 to zoning contracted services to help expand the processing capacity of the zoning and planning office, also introduced at July 25th. Any questions on that one? Any comments from the administration?
Just one. As was explained with the 5G zoning ordinance amendment, there's been no slowdown in development activity here in the city and in the planning and zoning offices. Thank you to council for approving the zoning administrator last week. We still have some staffing challenges. This funding will help us to keep development projects moving apace. Thank you.
Then we have introduction of new ordinances, and usually Mr. Butler reads that for us, reads it right on the record. It's extensive. It's a lot. I don't know if you want to go ahead and practice reading them now. I'll defer to the city solicitor. Do we have to do that, or should he go ahead and read it?
He doesn't have to read them now. He would just have to read them at the regular meeting.
Yes, Marcia.
Yeah, and devil details here, but they are grouped as far as committee recommendations and mayor's additional recommendations, which is the way that they were received. However, I would prefer that we amend the headers when we come to a consensus after one day's meeting, that they all be blended together and have neither. It's not going to be council's recommendations. It's not going to be the mayor's recommendations. Agreed. It's not going to be the committee's Redding's recommendations. Okay.
Right. So when we when it gets on the agenda, it reads city ARPA recommendations.
Right.
Okay. And then, Mr. Butler, just for clarity, we have to add 9 and 10, where it says ARPA review committee, to reflect the Million Youth Chess Club and the Olivet Boys and Girls Club. So if you could just make a note.
Hold up, can you explain that again? What are you saying?
Okay, so when you turn to page 5, where it says ARPA review committee recommendations. Oh, Linda's explaining it to you. Thank you, Linda.
Thanks. So I'm adding that to.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And if I could just clarify one thing, the actual ordinance itself that is being introduced doesn't make any of the distinctions between committee or mayor recommendations. It does say the city of Redding approves the following appropriations. So that's just more for clarity agenda.
Thank you, Mike. Okay. And then this is all ARPA. All right, then that would bring us to resolutions. So we have resolution 112-2022 forgiving in its entirety the $1,475,000 loan originally extended to the previous owner of River Oak Apartments by River Oak Development LLC, aka Redding Housing Authority, by that certain amended and restated promise to renew dated September 17, 2008, and to release the mortgage securing said loan tabled at the July 11th and July 25th. And discussion was held at the August 1st Committee of the Whole meeting. Yes, Mr. Dauber.
I think it would be prudent to take and given information.
Okay, so at that point, you'll make the motion. Someone will make the motion.
Great. I'm sorry, why are we going to table it again?
We were provided with additional, so I am going to ask that you check your emails and we will further discuss at a later date.
Yeah,
please and thank you.
Something involving the housing authority that can't be discussed in public at tonight's meeting, but does warrant table further review.
Thank you for the clarity. Then we have a resolution all sent to the Planning Commission, appointing Rodney Ridley to the Planning Commission, appointing William Heim as manager. Obviously, we're going to separate the two. B and C, I'll read them together. D, I'll read separately. Do we discuss at this time? Any comments? Or will we wait till the public meeting? Okay, moving on. Then we have the resolution approving the conditional use application for a banquet hall at 46 South Frith Street.
Is there a need for executive session to discuss that at all? No. I don't know. Did you guys talk about it last week when I wasn't here? All right. If I could, I would ask for maybe 2 minutes in executive session to make sure we're all on the same page.
I think we should go to.
All right. So the time is 6:37. Is there any additional comments or concerns so that we can break for executive session? And then we will begin our meeting at what time? 7 p.m. on the dot. All right. The time is 6:37. So we're meeting in the clerk's office for executive session. Everyone, please make yourselves comfortable. There's plenty of chairs. we're going to remove ourselves and then we're coming back. Okay. We're going to start promptly at 7 p.m.